Mammography is a simple, painless breast screening procedure that could save women from a very painful and usually terminal disease, breast cancer. Early detection of breast cancer through mammography could lead to an almost complete cure of the disease. One then wonders why most of our women are not forthcoming to have this procedure done. We'll be discussing mammography in today's edition of the program. There will be more when we return. The program is Discourse. I'm Chinelo Bob Osamo.
Discourse will be back in a moment. Stay tuned.
No hear am? Sugar, flour, and vegetable oil where no get vitamin AI logo and NAFDAC registration number. Na katakata for anybody wey chop am. Person wey use salt wey get iodine inside, im brain go dey sharp and im bone go strong kakaraka. Only iodized salt wey dey for small size pack with NAFDAC number and map of Nigeria na im good for body. Drugs, drinks, cosmetics, and foods wey no get NAFDAC number, manufacturer's address, and expiry date na danger zone be that. No buy, no use. My brother, injection no better pass tablet. If person give you drug wey no get label, no gree. Because now you're right to know the name of the medicine where you want take. Now only toothpaste where they make for Ninja, now him NAFDAC register. If you buy and use Obodo Oyinbo made toothpaste, if it dabaru your liver and kidney, oh.
NAFDAC, they want to make you take away.
NAFDAC, safeguarding the health of the nation.
Welcome back to Discuss.
Joining us is Dr. Olatunji Olubumi, Senior Consultant Radiologist. Madam, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very
now,
much.
Now, we were talking earlier, you were quite passionate about mammography. Why is that so?
Well, the reason for this is that when you have a tool that can help you in, you know, preventing a deadly disease, okay, then you'll be happy to use it. But in a situation where you know of a solution to a bad thing, and people around you, not just people around, people close to you, because I believe all Nigerians are my relatives, and they don't tend to see what you are seeing. What I mean by that is that mammography is a very good tool, okay, in detecting early breast cancer at the stage at which it can be treated, at least taken to a level where you can live with it. Because in the Western world now, people, women are living with cancer. And they die of other, they live to you know, old age and die of other causes of death. You know,
the number of women that come for this procedure is not encouraging.
It's not at all. And the reason for that is with the little interaction I've had with women, and when I say women, I'm not talking about the rural women alone. I'm not talking about uneducated women alone. You understand? Not only those ones, even the educated. They tend to want to have this type of a posture that I'd rather not know what will kill me. Something will kill me anyway. Why trouble myself on something that is not bothering me? And the real thing is that what mammography screening of breast cancer is actually doing is that you are not having any symptom at the stage at which this early breast cancer will be detected. It's not giving you any pain, it's not giving you any problem. Sometimes you don't even know it's there, but the mammography examination will reveal it. And from that stage, treatment starts. And then you are put at a almost, you know, neutral level.
You have a greater chance of surviving.
That is it. And the prognosis, the outcome is very good. People are no more talking about 5-year survival. Now they are talking of 10-year survival in the Western world. But we are still groping with 5-year survival, and it's a shame.
Because it's never detected early.
Yes, most of I'm going to show you some pictures. Those are a lot of women come at the last stage where nothing can be done for them except palliative treatment, that is tender loving care, and they waste money. And we doctors know that nothing will come out of it.
And they are in pains.
And they are wasting good money that they could use to invest on their children. Are you getting the point? Or more productive things.
Yes. And mammography is not really expensive.
It's not very cheap. At least in my hospital here, National Hospital, we do it in my Department of Radiology. We have a mammography unit. I believe every woman, even a market woman, can afford it.
What do you think is responsible for this apathy? Nigerians usually don't go for general medical checks and all of that.
The stage at which mammography will pick this disease is what we call the pre-malignant stage. Okay? That is what we aim at when we are doing breast screening. It's not for lumps, although you pick it. But the main thing when you do breast screening is to catch the disease at the very pre-malignant stage. So that because that pre-malignant stage that is called Ductal Carcinoma in situ, DCIS, may progress to cancer, and it may stay at that stage for life. It won't regress, but it may stay at that stage for life.
If treated?
No, even without treatment. But you don't know, there is nothing that is still in place now that will tell us that, this woman that has this DCIS will progress to cancer or not. I don't know whether you get what I'm saying. So when you know a devil, it's better you quickly
nip it
at the bud. You understand? Rather than allow it to become a blossom flower when it will be difficult for you to do anything.
At what age should women go for mammography?
Good. That's another very good thing, because we see a lot of people come. After we've done things like that, you see women of 20 years coming. No, we can't do mammography at that stage. You start doing...
Why can't they do it at that stage?
Okay, the reason for that is that mammography, though very sensitive, okay, but at that stage, that young age, the breast is still very glandular. And the glandular breast contains a lot of, glandular tissue, connective tissue that will appear very, very dense on mammography. Thereby, if there is even any lesion, okay, we will not be able to pick it up. It's going to hide the lesion. So when you are now growing older, now the breast is now undergoing something we call involution, which is a form of wear and tear process, in which case you have more of fatty tissue in the breast. It now allows the mammography to be very lucent. That is, it becomes dark and we'll be able to appreciate any lesion.
What is the ideal age?
The ideal age now is, usually we don't do below the age of 35. We expect every woman to come to have mammography, the baseline, at the age of 35. But the screening itself starts at the age of 40.
What's the difference?
Difference of what?
The baseline and the screen.
The baseline is for us to see. By that age, we expect you shouldn't have any problem, so to say. You understand?
Okay.
So that would be like your own standard. By the time you are now 40, if there's any problem, we will now use that to compare. At that age of 35, we expect, you shouldn't have it. Nobody knows. In fact, we've seen women less than that age having cancer.
Usually when our own comes, it's almost at the terminal stage.
Exactly. In the UK, where I did my subspecialization in breast imaging, every woman, by the time you are 50 years and you are registered to a general practitioner, a GP, as they are called, you are served a letter to go to the nearest screening center. And they don't just have them in hospitals alone. They even have mobile units. So they can say, okay, today we are going to be in Kuje. You people in Kuje that are 50 years, you'll be there. And if they find out that, because they do everything digital. But if they find out that, in August, we have more of women in
particular
in Stoughton, for instance, they go there. You get the point? Mm-hmm. So, I know we will get there. Initially, when I came back after my short training, I was overwhelmed. Each night I would cry. Where do I start from? Because number one, there is even no breast screening program. And then, who do we collaborate with? Who do we work with? Where do we even start from? Okay, and I felt, let's start breast screening awareness program. I had some series of lectures. I worked hand in hand with a lady, Princess Nikki. She's an NGO, she floats an NGO. But even with that, the awareness became better, but I don't think I'm happy with it.
Okay, let's look at married women or women who have had children.
Good.
They've breastfed some kids, and then those who don't have. Where do you have the incidence more?
It's more with women that are nulliparous, that is, they've not had children. And even women that have children and they don't breastfeed, it's also more with them.
So women who have not had kids, have not breastfed?
They have higher risk. That's what we say, higher risk.
Yes.
And then if you have positive family history, your mother or your sisters that were born by your mother had it, you have higher risk. You understand?
Right.
So that's it. Although there are many other risk factors, we even have genetic factors. When we talk about the BRCA1 and 2 genes, you know, if you have the mutation of such genes, you have a higher risk of doing. In fact, the trend now in the Western world is that when you go for genetic examination and you tend to have mutation of these genes, some women present themselves even for total mastectomy.
That's removing the breasts.
But you can't remove the whole breast. There will still be some remnants of the breast. If you are going to have it, you can still have it. So the best thing is the screening. And you once it's detected, and you know, mammography is so fantastic.
We have other methods of breast screening. One, they say you lie back and then check. What advantage has mammography over such ones?
Oh, mammography, I cannot tell you it has advantage over it. Mammography, the advantage actually, as I told you, is for older women. But when you do breast self-examination, which is what you're talking about, it's very sensitive in the younger women. But that is if you know how to do it. You don't do it every day. You have to, it's a study. You have to study your breast yourself. You must know your breasts. And how do you do that? You take a particular day of the month, preferably after you've had your menses, maybe day 5 of your menses. When you are finished bleeding, maybe if you run a cycle, like a 28-day cycle, and you bleed for 3 days, you rest for 2 days, by the 5th day, you now examine the breast. Why is that so? Every month, the breast goes through his own cycle, preparing for a child, just like the womb does, just like the ovary does. So when you get to a stage, especially the second phase, where the breast will now become very, very tender, nodular, you may get confused. In fact, if you touch your breast at that time, you may think you have lumps all over. Whereas it's just a normal phenomenon going on, because the breast is getting ready to feed a baby. So that once the womb is pregnant, the breast too is getting set. I don't know whether you get what I'm trying to say.
What you're saying.
So you have to pick a date. And usually I say day 5. That is if you bleed for 3 days. If you bleed for 5 days, let it be day 7 or even that day 5 or day 6.
Because most people don't know this. They just lie back and...
And even it's a systematic thing. You don't just grip your breast this way I'm doing. You use the pulp of your finger and you lie down. Is that you lie down or you stand? In fact, the standing is even better. When you are having your bath in the morning with the soap still on you, face the mirror. I'm sure most people have mirror in their bathroom. If you don't have, get a mirror and hang it there on that day you are doing the examination. No matter how small, as long as you can visualize your breast. And raise the hand that you want, the side of the breast. That, like, I want to examine my right breast. I will raise this hand up. And I'm going to use my left hand to examine this. That is when I get to the stage of palpation. And I go round all the breasts, I mean all the side, even to my armpit to feel, using the pulp of my finger, not the tip, or gripping through in between fingers. No. Because if you do that, the whole breast itself is a lump. And you'll be confused. But before, if you're actually doing a breast self-examination, the first thing you do is you stand in front of the mirror and you grip your waist. That is to make the muscles, what we call the pectoralis muscle that is behind the breast, to be firm. And that allows the breast also to be firm. And when you do that, you look. Is there any dimpling? Is there any breast that is sagging? Or even one breast bigger than the other? But usually, one breast is bigger than the other in most women. It's a normal thing. But if your breast has not been like that before, for God's sake, report to the doctor. If you notice a sudden change in the size of any of the breasts, you should report to the doctor. And if there's any dimpling, you check your nipples. Is it going inward, what we call inversion? Or is it getting upturned? Or is there any excoriation?
No, is it peeling off? Inversion and upturn, which one is the sign of trouble?
Both of them. That is something, you know, it can either invert, go in, or something is maybe is up there and it's pulling it up. It's also a sign of trouble. It can pull down too, depending on where the lesion is, I mean the mass is. So you do that, that's what we call inspection. Then after that, you go for the palpation that I explained earlier on. Then lastly, you now have to press a little tug on the nipple. Don't overpress, because even if me at my stage I've breastfed children before, if I press too much, milk may come out. But we know how milk looks like. If it comes, I'm not bothered. But if it is bloody or greenish or any other color, report to the doctor. Very important. But don't press too much. And worse still, if you notice that you have some secretion into on your brazier, you note it. That means that one is just coming out on its own without even any, you know, pressure. Yes, there is. That shows you have nipple discharge. But even the nipple discharge, don't be the one to analyze it yourself. Let your doctor do the analysis. Even if it is milk, let the doctor see it and tell you, oh, it's ordinary milk. You are okay, and it gives you a clean bill of health.
So men are big busted. Should they also come for mammogram?
Well, yes. I've done series of, we've done series of mammography for women here, I mean for men here, because the risk of, there is also the risk of having breast cancer in men, but it's very low, by 1%. But you know,
the size of the breast,
no, the size is not, it doesn't determine it. Because when you have increase in the size of the breast in men, we call it gynecomastia. Such men, the first line actually for them would be for them to come for ultrasound. We do ultrasound for them. If there's any lesion, we will see it. But most times you just see that it's just fat that is there. That is gynecomastia. And if they feel bad about it, they may do cosmetic surgery. Doctor removes the fat for them and then they feel okay with it. Otherwise, it's not troublesome. But gynecomastia too can predispose to breast cancer. But not all of them will, and nobody knows who will progress to having cancer or not. And when there is cancer in men, it's more devastating. It's more virulent.
So what would you advise? All men should queue up and come
for mammography. We can't accommodate that. But if they feel any unusual, because theirs is easier. Most men, they don't have this, they're flat-chested. Mm-hmm. So when you notice that there's anything in you, you quickly come. I actually designed it, and I'm so gracious to the chief medical director of this hospital for granting this pamphlet to be, you know, produced. And we had quite a lot of it. And what it's all about is breast screening using mammography. And you can see that ribbon there is actually the breast cancer logo. The ribbon, pink ribbon. The HIV is red.
Okay.
This is pink. It's a ribbon of love. We are actually in the mammography room, where we have the mammographic machine. And this is the mammography console, operator's console. It's computerized. The machine we have here is not a digital mammography unit. It's analog, but it is highly computerized. Here you put the patient's name, the age, the radiographic factors they are using, you input it here, and then you take the patient to the mammography machine itself, which is here. This is the slot where you put the cassette. And the woman's breast is put in between these two paddles. And this serves as the compression, which will be, you know, controlled from the applied and controlled from the operator's console there. And one good thing about this machine is that in this position, you are able to do the, because you are expected to do two views for each breast. That is the craniocaudal, which is, we call the up and down, and the mediolateral oblique, which is like the side to side. And this machine is so fantastic, it could be turned itself using the, doing it at the operator's console to 45 degrees. And when you get to 45 degrees, it actually stops, it's indicated. And the woman is so positioned to do the side to side, that is the mediolateral. By doing those two views, you now be able to appreciate the breast in a three-dimensional manner. When you are coming for this examination,
okay,
you are expected to come without any roll-on under your armpits, without any talc powder, because this will actually serve as, they will create artifacts, and which may, you know, confuse the doctor, the specialist that is going to examine, and it could be taken as microcalcifications.
What about perfume?
Even perfumes, just do away with it for that day.
Mammography is as simple as it is painless, but then it protects you from a very painful and usually terminal disease, breast cancer. Have you had a mammogram done lately? Do not procrastinate. Hurry now and get one done. Until same time next week when we come your way, thanks for watching. Good night.